Sid Show.
Guaranteed to be enormously successful.
It's about truth, the damn truth. New York's truth. The truth behind the BS. For New York, nothing at all in between. This is Bernard McGurk.
Bernard McGurk.
Sir Bernie.
This is Sid Rosenberg.
The one and only Sid.
Live, local, on it.
You never know what's going to happen.
Exclusively.
What is this?
77 WABC.
Never say where she came from. Yesterday don't matter if it's gone. While the sun is bright or in the darkest night, no one knows. She comes and goes. Goodbye, Ruby Tuesday.
Ah, perfect start to your beautiful, this is really a beautiful New York City Tuesday morning, the Rolling Stones classic, Ruby Tuesday. Welcome back to the Bernie and Sid Show right here on legendary 77 WABC, or maybe the Beatles.
Oh, it's the Stones, right? Isn't it? It's the Rolling Stones.
Of course. But we often do that with the show. You'll say, hey, that's...
Oh, yes, that's me. You're being silly.
Right.
Of course. For a second there, I thought you were actually questioning.
I had you. It's a gorgeous day. It's great to be here. It's always great to be on the air with you, my dear friend Bernard McGurk.
Sydney!
On a Tuesday, too, which means beautiful. I get a lot of Bernard today. I get Bernard on I Miss, and we did the Bernard and Sid Tuesday segment together. Once again, a smashing success. Then I get to the 2 hours with you, which is my career highlight. And then tonight, I get to watch you on Bill O'Reilly on Fox News.
Sid, you are making me blush.
It's true, though. Big Bernie day today.
Big day.
I left out the part where I meet you on your couch at about 12:45.
You were supposed to leave out that part.
And pick edamame out of your butt.
Come on. Listen.
Left that out.
And Sid Rosenberg had the big debut of the Sid Rosenberg podcast here on WABC Radio.
It's very exciting. My whole career, of course, at least I've been doing this now for like 20 years. I can't believe it. But the first 15 years or so, it was exclusively sports and obviously highlighted by WFAN here in New York. But three different stations over a decade, Bernard, down in South Florida, where most of my work was sports. Only the last 2 or 3 years on my morning show in Florida did I decide to move away from sports a little, add news, add politics, which worked out well because now I got the dream job of a lifetime working with you. But most of my career was sports. That's how a lot of people still identify me. So they offer me this podcast, and the money they offer me, which is nothing, how do you turn that down?
Well, you just say, what do you mean?
You can't.
Wait a minute.
It's a labor of love.
That's right.
It's something you enjoy doing.
Right. No, but kidding. Actually, though, it's going to pay off.
It's so fun. Yeah, you know your stuff. And as I said to Mr. Imus this morning, even if you don't, you say it with such authority. So authoritatively.
That's right.
It sounds like you know what you're talking about.
It's all about conviction, which I've got a couple.
We have a little sample. You
and me
hear
both.
Of the podcast
morning? The Sid Rosenberg Sports Podcast on WABC Radio.
Right now it's on our podcast page, but it will be on its own separate podcast.
Right, we've got a separate Sid on sports page, but right now if you go to WABCRadio.com/Bernie and Sid, the podcast is live.
And let me just say this, F-bombs flying all over the place.
F-bombs, S-bombs, and we had a guest today.
C-words.
C-words.
Like catchers and
uncensored Sid.
Calls.
It is really uncensored, bro, seriously.
All right. And okay. Brian, words, Tuesday.
Brian Baldinger, former NFL player, he works with the NFL Network. He does a weekly game for Fox. For the NFL local kid from Long Island. He was my first guest today. Very good.
When you said Baldy was going to be your first guest, I thought it was going to be me. But I was really disappointed.
And he has a full head of hair, Brian Baldinger, unlike you and I. True. But it came out great today. It was fun.
Well, let's listen to a little sample.
All right.
Is Sid doing a sports podcast?
Yes, he is. Matter of fact, for WABC Radio.
I bet that could be pretty good.
WABC. This is Sid on Sports.
The pressure situation.
A production of WABC Radio New York. A look at the world of sports in New York and across the world.
He can fire the shot heard round the world now.
Out of Houston. Houston ducks under. Got it!
Little roller up along first. Behind the back. It gets through Buckner. Here comes Knight and the Mets win it.
Sid Rosenberg.
All right, well, here it is, the much-anticipated debut of Sid on Sports here on WABC, a cumulus effort, and, well, there it is. That's amazing.
Fantastic.
Not long after that was the effort, and really not long after that, like moments after.
I want to go listen right now. No, seriously, that's a kick-ass opening right there.
Chris Libertini, who works here, who, to you guys out there, have no idea what it is, but he did a really good job with that. The Bobby Thompson home run, the shot heard around the world, the Bill Buckner, Mookie Wilson ground ball that got the Mets against the right. All that is in there. He did a very, very fine job. So it's going to be a weekly thing. Week one is up today, and if you still like sports and me and all that stuff, we hope you enjoy it.
Did you talk about the unfortunate Dwight Gooden situation? I mean, he's on the front page of the New York Daily News. Looking very, very gaunt and thin.
You know, I didn't. I basically just set up the podcast, what I did before, how it happened, and I talk NFL with Brian Baldinger. But I told you this. I reached out to Dwight Gooden on Sunday morning. I was actually sunning myself in my sister's backyard in Brooklyn. Swear to God, I sent him a text. I go, hey, Doc, it's Sid. Just tell me you're okay. If not, what could I do for you? And I swear to you, in 2 seconds, Bernard, 2 seconds, he sends me back, everything is okay. And I said, okay, great. If it's not, whatever, we'll have lunch. So then yesterday, I had heard he called into Joe Piscopo's radio show here in New Jersey that he was doing okay. So I sent him another text and said, listen, I know you and I spoke for a couple of seconds yesterday. If you want to come out with me and Bernard today to a real audience, no disrespect to Joe,
right,
then hop on with us. He did not answer.
And talk to somebody who knows a thing or two about a situation like that. But it's a sad horrible situation.
Well, it depends who you believe. He says, I'm fine. Daryl Strawberry says he's not. His girlfriend says he's not. And the picture of him on the Daily News says he's not.
That picture's from yesterday. It does not. Pictures don't lie. No. He doesn't look good. But listen, we keep him in our prayers. Speaking of which, right now, another down note. As we speak, they're holding the funeral for former NYPD police chief John Timoney right now at St. Patrick's Cathedral. Yeah. And Bill Bratton is actually going to deliver the eulogy. Got a nice little piece to John Timoney, who was a great man, a good guy. I mean, just he was Bo Deedle's partner for years and years. He's a servant to New York City, and he deserves the kind of send off he's getting this morning. Died at 68 of lung cancer. He was a true New York hero. Grew up in Dublin. Actually, came to this country when he was like 11 years old. Still had the Irish accent. Anyway, rest in peace, John Timoney. I would say that. And I just wanted to make that mention because he deserves it.
He does.
Needs to be acknowledged.
His name actually came up in a conversation we had not that long ago. We were talking about doing the 9/11 show and possibly even doing our show this year from Ground Zero. And John's name came up.
Thought of him right away.
Right. And then Bo called us maybe days after and said John had passed away. So.
He was also the police chief of Miami while you you lived down there for years.
Yes.
And I got to know him through the I Miss the Morning show and actually at the 2000 Republican National Convention in Philadelphia when he famously at one point he was actually patrolling the streets on a bike. And there was this one famous picture of him actually subduing a perp. And he got off the bike and he was a hands-on guy is the kind of guy he was. And I actually had a few beers. I was honored to have a few beers with him at the Republican National Convention.
So that is cool.
Rest in peace to him. Now, Bill Bratton, for his part, he's tied into this Clinton Global Foundation, all these new emails that have been released that she was hiding.
Ooh.
That the this Republican, this right-wing organization, Judicial Watch, had to file a FOIA request, Freedom of Information Act request. I know it makes your eyes glaze over.
Oh, my God.
But here's the thing.
Yeah.
The guy who ran the Clinton Foundation, I mean, they outlined a whole bunch of quid pro quos that are actually stunning. How she sold out this country for personal gain, speaking fees, travel expenses, all this stuff, and ran it also as a patronage situation. It gave out jobs to a bunch of people. The guy who ran the Clinton Global Foundation, he now runs a quote-unquote consulting firm.
Is this Doug Brand you're talking about?
Doug Band.
Oh, Band, right.
And that consulting firm paid Huma Wiener, Huma Abedin, he paid that firm paid her while she worked at the State Department with Hillary Clinton.
Yeah.
But also,
I think they paid Cheryl Miles too, I think. Cheryl Mills,
perhaps. Right. I know they paid Uma $15,000 a month she was getting.
Good for her.
While she was working at the State. But here's what is leading me back to Bill Bratton. I'm taking her around full circle.
Right. Because you had to make sure you got in the Hillary, the emails, the corruption, all the nonsense I got to tell you, most of us don't care about anymore.
I know. But I had to say the reason why. I don't want to bash Bill Bratton while he's giving a eulogy for John Timoney, but Bill Bratton was an apologist for Bill de Blasio, which is shameful.
But you are bashing.
And then he sold out to Hillary Clinton. But why is that? Because he's going to work for Doug Band's company.
Right.
Teneo.
I told you that.
But the same company that paid Uma Abedin. I'm just pointing out to the audience here.
I told you the day he resigned, I said he's probably got a job with the Clintons. Did I not say that back then?
You did. And I'm telling you who he works for specifically. And that is this guy who used to run the Clinton Global Foundation, this Teneo firm, which paid Uma Abedin all in the thick of the corruption. That's why Bill Bratton is actually an apologist for Hillary Clinton, even though she calls cops racists, and she panders to the black community by misrepresenting what the cops do.
Right,
and he sold out, and that's why he's the face. She met with him the other day in this meeting, giving her cover, and it's pretty disgusting that he would do that. Even as he gives this eulogy right now, I just had to point the whole thing out, tie it all up in a nice big bow, because it's all out there in the news this morning.
You got to do it. Although you should be happy, because you often bitch and complain, and you're right about it, that the mainstream media never talks about the negatives for Hillary Clinton. I will tell you that I watched every network this morning. I was here early because of our IMUS appearance. MSNBC, all over the Hillary emails. CNN, all over the Hillary emails. Now, the difference is on those stations, people speak about it realistically, which is nobody cares. On Fox News, it's the end of the world. Oh, my God, this is it. We waited. It's finally going to happen. She's going to jail. Stop.
Well, look, it may not be resonating with people, but it needs to be examined. In fact, it shouldn't be Judicial Watch that discovered these emails, that filed this FOIA request.
It should be the State Department.
It should be 60 Minutes. It should be ABC News. It should be news organizations doing this stuff. Right. In an ideal world, I mean, this is how Watergate was exposed, wasn't it? It was 60 Minutes. It was Woodward and Bernstein.
But I did hear
But now, let's look the other way.
I did hear you say this morning, and this is why we fight back and forth, but it's all in jest, because to your credit, I'm going to give you credit here. You're a smart guy. You know the deal. And I did hear you say this morning on IMUS, who cares about the emails? People voting for Donald Trump, they care about the emails.
It's like Benghazi.
Right. The people who are voting for Hillary Clinton, and she's going to win, we don't care. And the moderates out there, I'm telling you, it's gotten to the point where they don't care either. The only people that are driving this email point home are the folks voting for Donald Trump and Fox News. And you said that this morning. Basically, anonymous.
A lot of our listeners also.
They're all Trump supporters.
Whatever it is.
Gracie on line three. People care. No, you care, Gracie, because you're voting for Donald Trump. The majority of folks that are voting, which will be for Hillary, she's going to win. We don't care.
It's Trump's job, and it's also the media's job to make people care.
That's different.
And if they can accomplish that, and Trump's back on the upswing right now, I must tell you.
He gained a point.
And his appeal to
point.
Blacks and Hispanics, we have the tape from
last
night.
Oh, it's going through the roof. Through the roof.
Trump is on a comeback.
Tony Powell said this morning, I'm going for Trump now. That's it.
Tony Powell, who was wearing his Black Panther shirt this
morning.
What
was that all about? Anybody else offended?
I swear to God, he's wearing his Black Panther shirt. 1-800-848-9222. Bernie and Sid back after this.
Bernie and Sid on demand.
You never know what's going to happen.
WABC radio app. Download it now. Upload the BS. 77 WABC.
This is Bernie Kerik, the former New York City Police Commissioner, and you're listening to the Bernie and Sid Show on 77 WABC.
The great Bernard Kerik back here on the Bernie and Sid Show. So we got the Hillary Clinton stuff in there. The emails, obviously, got to be a part of today's conversation. 1-800-848-WABC. 1-800-848-9222. Trump speaking, all that good stuff. And former New York Jet, now doing a very good job alongside Bob Wischusen during regular season games and on TV with Ian Eagle during preseason games. Our good buddy Greg Buttle live in studio next hour.
Oh, the Buttle man.
And he's great. Unlike the guest we had yesterday. Let's take it back quickly. Dave Navarro joined me and Bernard yesterday. Guitarist Jane's Addiction. Spent some time with the Red Hot Chili Peppers as well. And this was a four-hanger abortion, this interview.
I haven't heard that one in about 30 years. A four-hanger abortion.
Yeah, this was bad,
wow.
Bro.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it was so bad, it was actually good. And we're going to take you back to a little bit of the interview from yesterday, and then we're going to pose a question to our listening audience based upon the conversation that took place after this disaster went down. Here's Dave Navarro with Bernie and Sid from yesterday. Well, let me ask you a question, Dave. What are you so upset about? The fact that we brought up Guns N' Roses or a drug addiction or rumors about a girlfriend?
I'm not upset.
Well, you sound upset. To be completely honest, you got all quiet and kind of jerky, to be honest. So what's the issue?
The issue is that the line of questioning at this hour isn't necessarily what I...
What should we ask you? That's in the news today. That's in the news today, Dave, about Cantaros. What should we ask you? Could I ask you about the porn movie, too, or should I ask you about that?
A year and a half old.
Dave, could I ask you about the porn industry, too, or should I stop not ask you about... Because that was also 15 years ago. Is that okay to ask today?
It was. It was 15 years ago.
So could I bring that up, or is that not okay with you?
Sure, you can bring up anything you like, bud.
Hey, did you see the Conor McGregor fight?
I did not.
How do you feel about Trump?
Wow. That is a tough one, man.
Come on. Give us something, bro. Give us something.
What do you guys...
What a bitch.
God. And people are worried about Dwight Gooden, huh?
Good Lord. Yeah, maybe, you know, that's, God forbid, maybe he was there with a needle hanging out of his arm because he wasn't on. He was off. I mean, we brought up legitimate topics that are in the news, and he started sulking on the air.
Yeah, got a little baby. So to make a long story short, I think he spoke to, well, I'll let Flipper tell the story. Flipper, you spoke to Dave after that, and what was the ensuing conversation?
He basically wanted to call up yesterday, and I said, well, unfortunately, the show is over, and he said he would call up today. And I said, you know, maybe next time you're in studio, you're in New York City, we'll have you in studio.
Yeah,
but
so
he was being pretty nice.
I'm sure. For the record, and I haven't talked to Bernard about this, so Bernard, you'll tell your piece now. I don't want him back. He was a complete jerk off. We gave him two or three opportunities throughout the interview to come around and play along. And he's Dave Navarro, man. It's not Bono. It's not Bruce Springsteen. No. He's Dave Navarro.
You're in your eighth season of Ink Master on some obscure cable channel, channel 492. And you know, like Sid said, you're not Mick Jagger,
right?
So we'll take a look. If he feels bad, he has second thoughts. Maybe after Labor Day, we'll talk to him again. But right now...
Here's what we'll do, Bernard. We'll go to the news here at Noam. If the listeners out there feel like he was a jerk, but we need to let it go, and maybe we should allow him to call in today and apologize, if, in fact, the listeners have the majority that say he should call in, maybe then you can sway our opinion. Is that fair?
Fair enough.
Yeah, call us now, 1-800-848-WABC, and we'll see who wins.
1-800-848-9222. As mentioned by Flirty Flipper, back after Noam with the news.
The Bernie and Sid Show.
It's fun to listen to.
800-848-WABC.
There could be an explosion at any time.
Get in. Get Truth 77-WABC.
Here we go.
Jane's Addiction for you. 1040. On your Tuesday morning, back with Bernie and Sid, former New York Jet linebacker, does the Jet games on radio, on television, and a big Donald Trump guy, Greg Buttle, coming up live in studio. He's already here. He's outside.
Yeah, big dude. Good guy.
Rubbing Lou Ferrino up and down.
I saw him massaging his shoulders.
Yeah, it's weird, man.
It was a little strange. But then again, you know, stranger things have happened in Jets locker rooms.
Oh, my God. We only knew, right?
He knows.
Well, he does know. You're right. But he was very hesitant last time to talk to you about any of that topic. You did ask him a couple of times.
You know what? I'll just slap it out of him today. How about that?
What are you talking about? Are you nuts? So we brought up Dave Navarro last segment. Before we get back to Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton and Greg Buttle and all that,
yeah.
We had Dave Navarro on yesterday. That was Jane's Addiction, the band he played with all these years. Turned out to be a complete disaster. I guess according to Flipper, he contacted her after and he wants to come back today. We think he wants to apologize and further the relationship. He actually did say, with the exact verbiage, I don't want to fight with those guys. He said that.
Well, wise of him. Because, well, yes. First of all, he listen, not to disparage him at all. He acted like a, you know, like a dick yesterday. Right. But he's only 5'9". He's a little guy. So, no, he doesn't want to. I guess he doesn't want to verbally fight with us.
Right.
But he doesn't want to physically fight with us either.
No, I don't think he wants to. No. But I think he meant verbally. Now, just so you know, he blocked me on Twitter, which I'm this is a badge of honor for me. And he has not. He has not unblocked me from Twitter. So the fans, we gave you listeners out there an opportunity to call in. And
hey, listen, we kissed his ass, first of all, the whole first half hour. And then when he came on, we were like, wow, this guy's led a great life. And, you know, talking about all the women he's had and the shows he's done, musician, actor, that, the other. And then we pumped him up. And then we asked him some legitimate questions, and he acted just like a complete blank hole.
Well, somebody on Twitter came at me, they're like, well, you talked about his mother's murder. I'm like, listen, moron, if you know anything about this guy, he has a movie. It's titled Morning Sun, Mourning. He made a movie about it.
Where he turned it into a positive. He was exposing domestic violence and stuff
like
that.
He's out there talking. His episode on Dr. Phil, where he talked about his mother's murder and domestic violence, is one of the highest rated Dr. Phil episodes ever. So you cannot talk to Dave Navarro and not include that. And right up when he got pissed off with that right away.
Right.
It's almost like he wanted to come on and talk for 8 minutes about Ink Master. If his publicist wanted us to talk for 8 minutes about Ink Master, I would have said no.
Absolutely.
We don't want him.
Yeah, of course not. And they did not impose any limits or restrictions on our conversation with him. So anything was fair game.
Well, even
if they did, we would have done it anyway. Well,
right.
Or we would have just not had him on.
I'll always lie and say, yeah, we'll talk about whatever you want.
I mean, here's the facts. If he's going to go on with Imus or Howard, he's going to sit down and talk about his mother and Carmen Electra and all those things. Don't come on with us and expect us to be talking heads for 7 minutes about your stupid television show.
The fact that he was with Red Hot Chili Peppers and they left him out of the Music Hall of Fame.
Fair question.
His dating life with Andrea Tantaros. What's wrong with dating Andrea Tantaros? Is that taboo? Is she married? Are you married? What's the problem?
She might sue you after. That's the problem.
Well, not if she doesn't. She didn't work for Dave Navarro.
Right. Well,
maybe. Why don't you just leave that out?
All right. Yeah, right? I mean, come on.
Too late.
I'm begging you.
I'm trying to bury that thing.
But she. Look, I'd be wearing that as a badge of honor
damn
if I was dating
right.
Andrea Tantaros. I'm like, damn snappy. Yeah, we're engaged.
Talk about outnumbered.
Point is, we did nothing wrong. We asked nothing out of the ordinary, and he had an attitude from the very, very beginning. And with that said, we're still considering bringing him back, but that is up to you guys. So we put the phone number out there, and every single phone line is lit up. You guys want to talk about this. So.
Let's do it. Let's go to Jason from Connecticut first. Jason, you're on with Bernie and Sid. Good morning.
Good morning, guys.
Hi there.
What's up, man? What do you think?
Well, listen, man, I got to be honest. I hear your point. I think he had an off day, but I really think you kind of treated him like a chump. I'll be honest.
Why so?
Yeah, where?
Well, I just thought to myself, look, he's on for Ink Master. You know, I appreciate the fact that he's an 80s and like a 90s rock star originally. I get that. But, you know, there were interesting stories about him that you guys didn't bring up. One for which, you know, he visited his mother's killer. You know, that's...
Jason, no, you're right, and I wanted to get there, but once I brought up the murder of his mother, he was so... I lost him right there. There was no room. And, Jason, let me tell you something. In our audience, maybe three people watch Ink Master. So if we don't talk about the murder of his mother, the girls he's been banging, all that stuff, he's not an interesting guy. We were trying to make him interesting, and he did not want to play along at all.
Maybe you're right. I thought he contacted you guys because he thought that your target audience somehow was watching his show.
No. No.
Because I have no idea why he would even call you guys in. Because I'm listening thinking, okay, he called in, and you could be talking about the show, the kind of contestants, and you bring up things from 20 years ago, which obviously kind of pissed them off, let's be honest.
Right.
That's our point. Too bad. I mean, it's all fair game. And then that 20 years ago, dating Andrea Tantaros current thing.
That's today. But the other stuff, Jason, is an effort to make him interesting to an audience that, quite frankly, doesn't watch Ink Master. But if they hear this guy has been involved in all these things and is helping out with domestic violence, all of a sudden on a station like this, he could become an interesting guy. We tried to help him, and instead he bit the hand that fed him.
Right, and then we tried to have fun also about his musical past and his love life. There's absolutely nothing wrong with what we did, in our opinion. But you say have him back.
Have him back.
Adir from Brooklyn, you're on with Bernie and Sid on WABC. Good morning, Adir.
Hey, guys. Good morning. Like I told the call screener, hell no, don't put him back on. I was listening yesterday, and I was cringing the whole conversation. It was horrible.
Right. He made us feel like chumps, didn't he? He made us feel like that
way. Yeah, exactly. I mean, I disagree with Jason. I mean, I felt exactly that way. He made you guys feel like chumps. He was just avoiding questions. I mean, not answering right away, giving it time. Come on. You don't need that.
No, he was a complete D-bag, yeah. And so there you have one and one.
All right.
And Billy from New York City. Billy, you're on with Bernie and Sid on WABC. Good morning, Billy.
Hello, Bill.
Hey, guys. Yeah, I think you should give him a second chance if he wants to come on and explain why he was such a prick. I mean, I think you guys did a great job.
You guys did a great job yesterday.
And I got to be honest, I have a newfound respect for you guys after yesterday, because usually you guys are the ultimate ass kisses. And like yesterday...
You're right. We were kissing his ass. That's the point.
That's funny.
You are absolutely right.
Yesterday you weren't. Yesterday you guys really, like, he's like, listen, man, we're just trying to make you interesting. And the guy was like, I don't even say why he even called in. He didn't want to talk to you at all right from the get-go.
Well, we were pushed into being, men. I guess, because he was such a, you put us against the wall, right. We will fight.
We're going to fight you.
Right. You know, fight or flight.
That's it.
And we will fight. We had nowhere to go.
That's 2-1. Let's go to Mike in New Jersey. Good morning, Michael. How are you?
Morning, gentlemen. Hey. How are you today?
Good.
I'm calling to say that he is a complete and utter douche. If I could have reached through my radio and strangled that little half man I would have done that.
There you go, little half man.
He is a nobody. 99% of your audience has no idea who he even is.
Right.
And why would he waste everybody's time in coming on to the most popular talk show in New York?
There you go, Mikey.
To not say anything, to be a complete and utter D-bag. I don't understand it. And if he comes back on, I'm going to boycott your show for 30 minutes.
I love it.
You know, and Mike, so that would certify our ass-kissing status in the previous
right,
call. If we had him come on,
right,
if we had him come back.
But it's 2-2 now. We'll need an odd man vote here. We need like a 5 or a 7. It's 2-2.
Well, let's try John from Astoria. John, you're on with Bernie and Sid. Good morning, John.
Hey, what's going on, guys?
What's up, John? Thank you.
That being said, I actually think you should have him on. I mean, just for the fact that your show would be good for the show, people would be definitely tuned into that. I mean, isn't it like Radio 101 just to have to back and forth?
You know what, John? You bring up a fair point in that because it was such a disaster that people would come back for two reasons. A, hoping it's worse, or if, God forbid, it gets better, they may even like him. So you make a fair point, John. You do make a fair point.
That being said, I don't want to... You know, defend Dave Navarro. I could care less about any of his bands. I think they all stink. But I think you guys were kind of, you know, not that great to him. I mean, you obviously never met him before or anything. And, you know, Sid is, you know, you're a little hyper with people. I don't think they understand your personality. You know, you bring up all kinds of funny stuff or whatever.
But he's never met Imus before. He's never met Howard Stern before. They would do the same interview. I want the same respect. That's the point. And he'll sit there with those guys, and he'll go, he'll describe every detail. Don't come on the show with me and Bernard and shoot us like we're the high school guys. Because
he doesn't know your personality, though. We know you don't mean anything.
Well, it's just common. It's common courtesy. You're going on any broadcast show, radio, TV. You're going to be interviewed. Be prepared to answer any question.
You're talking about, but you can't just slip in his mom's murder.
Hold on. What do you mean? John, that's not right. Slip in. At the very beginning of the conversation, I said, listen, you've had a very interesting life. You've been filled with tragedy, with great things, but a lot of people saw your episode with Dr. Phil, were familiar with the story. Your mom was murdered right in front of you. I even said, we find it really cool that you've now devoted your life to domestic violence. I didn't slip that in. That's the biggest story of the guy's life.
Yeah, I know. You got to be fair, though. You know, you're all over the place with that topic. So, I mean, you got to kind of go with a kind of a flow if it comes.
John, don't teach me how to freaking interview. Thank you for your. But I'm all over the place with topics.
We have a poll on Twitter.
Yeah, there's a moron.
I get complimented
every single day on my interviewing style, but John from Astoria says I'm too hyper and I got to get I got to keep it flowing the right way.
Right.
Thanks, John.
We like the hyper Sid. We like that a lot. The passionate Sid. We have a poll going on Twitter on our Twitter page at Bernie and Sid WABCRadio.com. You can vote there. Also, Dave from New Jersey, around with Bernie and Sid on WABC. Good morning, Dave.
Morning. This just came off of TMZ.com.
coming this fall on Fox TV, the Dave Navarro Variety Hour, with Betty White, the Muppets,
and Andrea Tanteros.
Bruno Mars, special guests Anthony Kiedis, Flea, and Dennis Rodman. This guy makes Prince seem outgoing. Oh, at a show about watching people get tattoos, riveting.
Right. I mean, we promoted the hell out of that for the guy. We kept saying, Ink Master, whatever the channel it is. I kept injecting that in the middle of our questions, promoting the show. It was sufficient. Listen, this only guy's claim to fame is been caught stealing, really. That was the only thing that really shone back in the day. And it featured Hillary Clinton on the, he discovered a talent. Where she learned how to bark.
Basically.
Pretty much. So anyway, we have five. Did Dave say have him back? Dave, what was your vote?
I say have him back. And yeah. Sid, your interview style is too laid back.
Too laid back. You're right. You're
there
right.
There you have it.
Thank you, Dave.
Go to our Twitter page and vote, if you would, for Bernie on Bernie and Sid about this Dave Navarro. Should we have this... this little guy back on or not?
We'll close it with this. When I first heard we're having him on, I'm like, what the hell are we going to talk to Dave Navarro about? I swear to God, that's what I thought.
I know. Jill was hot to do it because she's like a major star effer.
I started reading up on the guy and his mother being murdered in front of him and the domestic and all that stuff. I go, well, hold on a second. That same day, Josh Brown, the kicker for the Giants, was a back page story in New York for hitting his wife, allegedly.
It was relevant.
Right. And I go, wow, this guy really is interesting. Then you get a guy like the last call to go, you slip in the fact his mother was murdered. That's his story, man. That's what makes Dave Navarro, believe it or not, interesting to everyday people and not just people who smoke dope, like rock and roll, and get tattoos.
That and Andrea Tanteros.
Correct.
And of course,
and Carmen Electra.
The fact that he made Hillary famous. Bernie and Sid back after this.
There she goes. Yeah.
Sid Show.
Guaranteed to be enormously successful.
It's about truth, the damn truth, New York's truth, the truth behind the BS. For New York, nothing at all in between. This is Bernard McGurk.
Bernard McGurk.
Sir Bernie.
This is Sid Rosenberg.
The one and only Sid.
Live, local, on it.
You never know what's going to happen.
Exclusively.
What is this?
77 WABC.
Yes, you're looking live at a sold-out MetLife Stadium where tonight the Jets will take on the Giants. That's coming up this Saturday, preseason football week number 3, the dress rehearsal, if you will, for week 1 of the regular season. And that brings us to hour number 2 of the Bernie and Sid Show right here on 77 WABC. And an esteemed guest, not just a great linebacker for the New York Jets, does Jet Games on radio with Bob Wischusen, Jet Games on television with Ian Eagle, but also a great businessman and big Donald Trump guy. Our good buddy and looking like $1 million.
One of the greats.
Greg Buttle. Welcome back.
Listen, boys, it's always nice to be with you two utes.
Yeah, that's right. You two young losers over here.
I didn't say losers.
No, you didn't say that. No, I said that because I'm self-deprecating. But anyway, it's great to have Greg Buttle here. New York legend, actually, I would say.
Yes.
And... look, you dressed like you just left Park Avenue.
Yeah.
To come over here. You got the pocket hanky. You got the $1,000 shoes with no socks on.
Meetings.
I mean, you really are a very dapper dude.
Point being is you can't be.
What are you trying to hide?
I'm not trying to hide. That's a funny line. You never can be too dressed for anything. So you just dress the way you are. You can always be underdressed like Sid.
Right. But I'd still look great like Sid. I don't have to wear the fancy suits and ties to look good.
I don't need a tan. I don't need a deep tan.
Look at these. These are gas in those.
What is that going to do for you?
You know about working
out. Yeah, exactly. Are you showing me biceps? Come on.
Yeah.
Well, what do you think of that? I mean, is this desire to pump up and look like Dwayne "The Rock" Johnson?
Well, there's a little narcissist going in.
Oh, right? Get out of here!
What do you mean?
Get out of here! In the good old days, when you owned the gyms all across Long Island, if in fact I got these at the Buttle gyms, you'd be pumping me up right now.
Right. I would have, but now you're out of the gym business. That's right. Forget that.
he took advantage of suckers like you for years.
Yeah, but you go to the nightclub. That's it. Or park your car at Air Park parking. Sure, go ahead. That's what I'm talking about.
I actually think I went to Buttle's once with I think it was Boy Gary from out in Long Island. We went to your club, and we got robbed.
Funny. You're so funny. You never were robbed.
No, they really did. Unlike Ryan Lochte, they really did.
The liquor was watered down. It was a terrible experience.
You got to do what you got to do. You know what I'm saying?
Listen, he ended up meeting Mark Gansino at Spratt's.
Yeah. Well, he was always down on the water. But
Spratt's on the water.
We came, all the Jets were back at my place after the game Sundays. It was spectacular. Everyone was nice. The crowd was nice. We were Cheers before Cheers was Cheers.
Is that right?
That's the truth. That Buttle's at the time on the Hempstead Turnpike was the place to be. And we would be down there Sunday night. We'd be back there on Monday afternoon. And it was great. All the players were down there. They loved it. I thought it was great.
You don't miss that business just a little?
I'm still in the business.
And that particular business?
They still have the same location. It's a different name now. Oh, it's called Aura.
But it's yours?
Yeah.
I didn't know that. Okay.
Greg Buttle's a really slick, smart businessman. People don't know that.
Here's how smart I am.
And a broadcaster on top. He's not like... He actually parlayed his athletic career into something useful, something productive, something lucrative, I would say.
Well, this is where I think that you know, if there's anything that I have in common with Donald Trump, it's that you got to know who the right people are to be with and who to hire. And the point being, I had two partners that were great, taught me the business, John Curtin and Ray Leone, and taught me the business. And I'm still in the same business, still my partners to this day. That's over since 1979. How's that?
You also, much like Donald Trump, have big hands, which means you must have a big, at least Donald Trump leads us to believe he's very well endowed.
When you turned around,
age, who cares?
When you turned around quickly in the locker room, you like smack somebody over the head.
No, he
the
did.
Temple with
no, he did.
Well, that's a funny line because I've always hated the fact that women were allowed in the locker room, but I hated the fact that men were in our locker room. That locker room, is not a place of business. Everyone wants to call it business. It's not. It is your living room, and that's where you live. That's every single day with the guys, and you just can't be comfortable with the media in your locker room.
However, if you were, you know, really well endowed, you'd be like, let them in. Let them in.
Right.
Can we read something into that, the fact that you didn't want women in the locker room?
No, you can't read anything into
Prove
that.
Prove it.
Want me to lay something on the desk over there? But anyway, let me tell you a real quick story, Greg. About Buttle's.
Yes, sir.
When I first owned was early 80s, and... There was this black guy that kept coming into the place, and he was a little guy. He would come into to Buttle's, and he'd come in, and he'd say, hey, Greg, how are you? How you doing? I go, fine. I didn't know who he was. So, yeah, come on, sit down. You know, listen, can I introduce you to my date? Yeah, sure. So I say hi to the date. He comes back in again. He's got another date. Comes back in again, another date. He goes, now, this is not the same girl. I just want to let you know. I said, fine. You know who that was?
Who was it?
Eddie Murphy.
Oh, wow.
Before Eddie Murphy was anybody. He lived in Roosevelt. He was coming up, and he was spending a little time on whatever nights.
You know, he was a comedian out with Rob Bartlett out on Long Island.
Great guy.
A place called the White House or something. There was a comedy club. He worked with Rob Bartlett. I know that.
What was the brokerage out on Long Island? What was that?
Governors?
That was one.
Governors, I think.
There was a couple, but I think there was one that's no longer in operation. But
I'm going to tell you something. At that time, you don't know. But he wasn't doing any of that.
Yeah,
but he was such a nice guy.
I could do buckwheat.
Such a nice guy.
He was.
When he made it big, I moved back in 2001 when I worked with you during IMUS. I lived in Tenafly, New Jersey. And on the hill in Tenafly, Eddie Murphy and Alonzo Mourning, all those guys lived, and he had this huge house and these big gates with an E and an M. I could walk there from my house, but I couldn't get in, but that's when he made it big. Tenafly.
So he used to have...
He likes the trannies, too. You like them?
Yeah, he likes that.
You like that, right?
The what? What?
The trans. Didn't Eddie Murphy like those?
Yeah. Well, he was on a. It was a urban legend. I think he was on a date once, and it turned out
it's a people thing. You know. Yeah, you love people.
I like the trans.
I love people.
Yeah,
that's all there is.
They're all good.
all I can tell you. Another one. Here's the funny thing is that we used to have a special deal. So all the Islanders used to come in also. Yes. And what I used to tell them, listen, if any of the teams come in, just have them call. So this one guy calls one day, early 80s, whatever it was, and my partner answers the phone. Partner Rennie goes, yeah, hi. This is so-and-so from the hockey team. I hear that you do a deal with professional athletes, and Rennie says, hold on for a minute. He goes, listen, there's this guy on the phone from a visiting hockey team. Should we offer these guys the same thing we give the Islanders? I said, who is it? He goes, some guy by the name of Wayne Gretzky. I go,
oh, my God.
Absolutely. Right. Absolutely. That guy's going to be a star. Now, this is early in his career.
Before. Yeah.
Before. I said, that guy's going to be a star.
You know who's a great guy? Dennis Potvin. I know the Ranger fans kill him. Potvin sucks. Right. Potvin sucks. But he lives in Florida now. He does the Panther games.
Dennis, great guy.
Great guy. I mean, he probably frequented your bar, right?
Oh, they were all over there. Between here and Mr. Generosities at the time.
Right. Well, let me ask you then one question.
John
before
Tinelli,
we get
Clark
to,
Gillies, yeah, Billy Smith.
Bobby Nystrom. Before we get to the Trump and all that good stuff then, while we're talking about sports, you do the preseason football games on television with Iron Eagle. You guys are great. Great together.
Very nice.
You just did the Redskins game. For the Jet fans listening out there, there are tons listening to us right now. Is Geno Smith going to make this team? Because what I heard was Bryce Petty is going to be the backup to Ryan Fitzpatrick. You got the rookie out of your alma mater, Hackenberg, out of Penn State. What's Geno Smith's future with the Jets?
First of all, he threw an interception. I don't know how he threw it. I wasn't back there, but I watched
like
him.
A girl.
Well, no, he throws a good ball. I will tell you. Sean Hannity throws like a girl, but he's good. You know, and I was a little surprised. Maybe he didn't see the kid or not in the defense that they probably haven't practiced in preseason yet. But that's beside the point. All quarterbacks throw interceptions. So to me, it wasn't such a big deal.
He throws a lot, though.
Well, first of all, you're characterizing a guy that didn't have wide receivers for the first 2 years of his career.
That's fair.
Under
yeah.
pressure,
fair.
A yeah. guy that you know was punched out by some guy. I mean, his career has been spotty for those reasons. Without me defending the guy or giving him excuses, because you always have to rise above everything around you to be good. So that's the one thing fans haven't seen him do is rise above things to make it better. And, of course, in New York, fans are they're tough. You know, you've got to be able to accept what they are and do your job and go out and do it the best you can. I think that he works hard. I think that there's all of these expectations. Now, I don't know what goes on through his head, but I like he's a nice kid.
You know, what was very telling, though, is when he got punched in the jaw, he didn't fight back. I mean, to me,
he's knocked out.
He was not knocked out. He didn't get knocked out. His jaw was broken.
I think he did hit the floor, though.
You get up there and you go after that punk.
Well, you get stunned. He broke his jaw.
Yeah. Right. But you get up and you start swinging back. From my neighborhood, that's what we did.
Well,
I don't know about you guys.
That's what McGregor would do.
Well, you know what? First of all, I was not there. No one was there. No one knows what happened other than they heard the scuffle. They came out and next thing you know, everyone's there. So I don't know.
Maybe I don't know. Maybe I should get some more facts. But
I think
I think you go after that son of a bitch. And, you know, and how about...
I'd have sued him civilly. I'd have sued him.
How about Rex Ryan hiring the guy that punched Geno Smith afterward? I mean, was that a slap at the Jets at the time?
I don't look at that as a slap at the Jets. I look at that. That was Rex Ryan's guy. The Jets caught him. That was Rex Ryan's guy. So Rex Ryan believes he knows how to get the most out of IK in whatever his last name is,
right.
Pacali.
Plus, he stuck it to the Jets.
Listen, he made him a captain, but he's always done that with teams with players from former teams. It's not something out of the ordinary.
Well, you know, Greg could be defending Rex Ryan on this because Rex Ryan is a Trump supporter,
is
Greg Buttle.
Yes. And also,
make America great again.
And also loves to suck toes. As does Greg
Buttle. There's nothing wrong with it.
Buttle loves that.
Is that illegal?
That's why Flipper wore the thongs. She's got the thongs on, the thong slippers, with the painted toenails, and she lives like two blocks from Greg Buttle.
Actually, it's 537 steps, but I'm just saying.
Every time he sees me coming, he's building that wall.
I was scared of her.
You better wear a French maid outfit.
She's done that twice.
Bring a little duster.
We hang out.
So you can accomplish two things at once. 1-800-848-9222. Greg Buttle is a Trump supporter. We're going to talk politics. Hillary was on with Jimmy Kimmel last night. She got out of bed long enough to go on Jimmy Kimmel last night.
She was funny.
And we have some of that. Greg's reaction to that. And also about the Giants having this.
The kicker, Josh Brown?
Yeah.
Get rid of this guy. We'll talk about that.
We'll talk
domestic
about
violence.
That. Yeah. And what happened to Mark Gastineau? 1-800-848-922. Bernie and Sid. And Greg Buttle in studio after this.
Bernie and Sid.
Bernie and Sid.
Live, local, on at 77 WABC.
It is a disaster the way African Americans are living in many cases, and in many cases the way Hispanics are living. And I say it with such a deep felt feeling. What do you have to lose? I will straighten it out. I'll bring jobs back. We'll bring spirit back. We'll get rid of the crime. You'll be able to walk down the street without getting shot. Right now, you walk down the street, you get shot. Look at the statistics. True. We'll straighten it out. If you keep voting for the same failed politicians, you will keep getting the same results. They don't care about you.
Yeah.
They just like you once every 4 years. Get your vote. And then they say, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Donald Trump, speaking to the nation yesterday. He is right about one thing.
Addressing blacks and Hispanics in particular.
Right. Of course, there were no blacks or Hispanics in that audience.
No, but they were watching TV.
Oh, they're all watching, I'm sure.
No, they have TVs, believe it or not.
Right. And they're all making it sure. They're all making sure they're watching Donald Trump on TV.
Oh, people do watch. The ratings skyrocket.
Yeah, white people do.
That's why CNN and Fox cut in for Donald Trump.
White people do. But I will say this. What he got right was the definition of insanity is to do the same thing over and over again and expect different results. He's right about that.
Greg Buttle's in studio with Bernie and Sid here. His appeal is a populist one. What the hell do you have to lose? That's what appeals to me about his candidacy is what do I have to lose? The same crap with Jeb Bush, the same crap with Hillary Clinton. I'm willing to roll the dice and take a chance with a guy like this.
Never ending, never ending. And it's a disservice to the people in this country that welfare has been out there forever. How has that helped anybody? Where is it where they help with jobs? Well, none of that.
Right.
They just use it as a ploy to get votes.
And then, as he says, every 4 years they address the problems. They give lip service to it, and then they get elected. Bye bye.
And by the way, it's not just a Hillary Clinton. It's the whole liberal side of it, and half the Republicans that go along with all the nonsense.
Exactly right. He's going to stop spending the billions overseas, going to secure the borders so cheap labor doesn't come in and take jobs. And, I mean, I'm willing to try that. I'm willing to try stop spending billions and billions. Rebuild Detroit. Rebuild Penn Station.
How's he going to do that?
Spend the money here.
How's he going to do it?
He's going to stop spending the money overseas.
Right.
That's one.
Right.
And he's going to secure the borders so the cheap labor doesn't come in.
Okay.
Well, so that people can get jobs.
Is it you don't believe that because no Democrat has ever done that?
Why
is it that you would not believe that?
Because I haven't heard him to do it.
I said,
it's very easy to go on stage and talk about all these magnificent things you're going to do. All these things cost money, okay?
Right.
And realistically, Donald Trump has not come up with a plan yet to pay for anything.
I just explained it to you.
No, you didn't. He says all the right things. He has never...
Here's the difference.
Bernard does. Donald Trump doesn't. I've never heard Donald Trump in detailed fashion explain anything.
I'm going to tell you why.
Greg.
His emotions rule everything.
Yeah, he's very passionate. You got to love Sid for that.
Really, and there's nothing wrong with passion, but you've got to get to a point where emotion...
Would I vote for Trump?
No, where emotions don't rule your decision.
Greg, I've never heard Donald Trump detail anything. I've heard his last three speeches, which I thought were okay.
He hasn't detailed anything.
No, nothing.
The border.
Nothing.
What is Hillary Clinton detail?
No, don't talk about Hillary Clinton.
I'm just asking you the question.
Don't fight for Donald Trump by mentioning Hillary Clinton.
Here's the question I have.
Yeah.
What has anybody detailed that's running for office? What are their details?
Very little. Very little.
So what's the... I'm just asking him.
I'll tell you why. Because when people say it can't get worse, or what do I have to lose, that's about the dumbest thing I've ever heard. Because in any situation in life, whether it's football, politics, or how you're living, it could always get worse. It could always get worse, and you've got plenty to lose. And what I see from Donald Trump is a man without a plan. So as bad... And I don't like Hillary. I don't like Hillary. But it can certainly get a heck of a lot worse.
Allow me. His plan to secure the border has been well known for a long, long time. Also, also his plan to to make NATO, to make South Korea, to make Japan, to make stop for
what is his plan to secure the border?
Going to Saudi
what is his
Arabia.
Plan to secure the border? I want to hear it. What's his plan?
It's to build a wall. It's, right. it's okay. secure.
And who's paying for it?
Maybe a virtual wall.
And who's paying for it?
I don't care who's paying for it. He's not going to deport millions and millions of people. That's A.
Oh, he's still sticking with that, though.
No, he went.
He's still sticking with that.
Order the deal. You reach for the stars and you settle on.
He's still sticking with deporting 12 million people.
I won't deport, but I will build a wall. Right. And he will do that, and that's going to stop the cheap labor from coming in.
Right.
And that will help people
he
get jobs.
He will not do that. He will not do that because no one's going to pay for the damn wall. And secondly, he still wants to deport 12 million people.
So here it is. So you got one guy that, let's just assume he says he's going to deport 12 million people.
Right.
You want the other side that's going to import 12 million people, right? That's what you want. Open borders. You want anybody to come in.
Here's what I'm saying.
Our borders are right.
Here's what I'm saying.
Kids coming
through
Mexico.
Here's what I'm saying, okay? San Bernardino.
And drugs.
Oh, it's unbelievable. So the question is that's what you want.
San Bernardino, those guys.
No, is that what you want?
Hold on. Let me explain it, okay?
Well, see, you can't do what I do.
Let me explain it, because all you do is yell. You guys get hysterical.
No, San Bernardino. A question.
San Bernardino, they were Americans. Omar Martin was an American. The guys from Chechnya moved here at 4 years old. They were Americans.
Away. Take terror away.
They were immigrants.
Take terror away.
I'm trying to.
Your whole argument is terror.
I didn't argue terror. I'm talking about illegal immigration. Is that what you just talked about?
Yeah,
illegal immigration?
About the wall in Mexico,
right? But
I didn't mention terror once. Did you mention terror?
I never brought it up.
Okay,
so I don't know what you're talking about.
Stick with the wall. Not all Mexicans are druggies.
I'm talking about illegal immigration, which costs our country hundreds of billions of dollars.
We need to do a better job at that.
It's killing our welfare system. You want to talk about it? Okay. Look at all the families that are coming over. Illegal immigrants that are on welfare.
Need to do a better job at that. You're 100% right.
Stop the bleeding.
Trump can do something with it, but we know. We already know because Hillary Clinton has said she's going to allow an amnesty. She's going to allow all these people to come in.
And has been in office since 2000 and has never proposed anything to do anything about it. 1-800-848-9222.
So we do know what she's going to do.
We're joined by Greg Buttle, former New York Jet, great, in the studio. And we're coming back after Nome with the news.
Get to Bernie and Sid now. 800-848-WABC. Where New York comes to talk. 77 WABC.
If I were running The View, I'd fire Rosie O'Donnell. I mean, I'd look at her right in that fat, ugly face of hers. I'd say, Rosie, you're fired.
All right.
That's not funny.
Give one more.
That's the funniest part, because that's not funny.
Yeah, then why'd you read it?
Right, Hillary Clinton, I guess she didn't pre-read
Perfect segue. Yeah. Why did she read it?
Yes.
Well, she didn't pre-read that, obviously. She was reading it for the first time. She's like,
you know that. You were there.
Of course.
Of course you were there. You know that.
Yeah. Just put it down.
She's never done that before. Everything she's done is pre-read, pre-done, pre-thought. Everything is done.
You think she's that good an actress that she actually said this isn't funny and pulled it off like that?
Yeah, you know what they were doing, Greg? I mean, she is a phony and everything is orchestrated and poll tests and
not
all
bad.
That stuff. You're right. Last night she was reaching into a jar to grab random statements that Donald Trump has said in the past.
Right.
And she happened to grab that one.
And she
grabbed Rosie.
Right.
Not the first time, probably.
And by the way, correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe that she grabbed another one and she was like, I'm not reading this.
She said, I'm not going to read it.
Right. Yeah.
I still don't take it back. She's always prepared.
You're right.
Yeah. Look, at that time, maybe not. Yeah, but it was funny.
Yeah, you know, she didn't say it was not funny until the audience didn't laugh. She was waiting for the laughter, but then when the audience was silent, then it was like, that's not funny. It was very awkward, which is why I played it, because I loved it. It was so...
Must have been a group
Only Rosie O'Donnell.
Right. Group of Republicans must have been in the audience.
Why do you say that?
Because they didn't think it was funny.
Well, Republicans don't think Donald Trump is funny either.
I thought that was funny. If I was in the audience and she read it, I would laugh.
But have you not noticed, Greg,
that... It must have been Democrats in the audience, I think you mean.
No, right? Republicans. They didn't laugh because she's a Democrat.
Oh, because she read. Right.
What Greg is not saying or refuses to accept is the fact that a lot of Republicans don't think their own candidate is very funny or good. There are more Republicans
that likes Hillary Clinton. None of them.
Let me tell you something. I saw Laura Ingraham on the air this morning, your friend Laura Ingraham, who you love, okay?
Absolutely.
And she said, let me say something about the Democrats. She never says anything nice about Hillary, the Democrats. She said, here's the difference. She goes, we got a bunch of Republicans that can't stand Donald Trump, and they make it public. They embarrass the guy every single day, and he may lose because of that. He says, say what you want about the Democrats. She says, they lack honor, actually, because here Hillary is involved in all this mess, and not once has a Democrat come out and bashed her. Yet, Republicans will bash Donald Trump for a tweet.
That's so our, that 40-year gravy train still exists.
Well, the point is, don't tell me the Democrats stay loyal to Hillary even
they
with her mess.
They don't like her. And loyalty is different than liking.
I don't like her either, but I'm going to vote for her.
Loyalty is different.
I don't
than,
like
you're,
her.
You're a loyal misogynist. What can I tell you?
I'm voting for a woman.
You're misguided. a woman, by the way, who rode her husband's coattails to where she is
she
now.
She deserves it. What he did to her, she should ride his coattails.
Yeah, she should be our president because of what the pervert did to his
she's
wife.
She's going
to
be our president because she's going to get the majority of the vote from the American
people. Here's what I think Bernie and I also agree on, which is it's the macro of this. It's not the micro thing of this. It's the micro of that. It's the macro, which the years of perjury, obstruction of justice, obfuscation of the facts.
Right.
What is the meaning of is and a defense with her from everything that goes back for the last 30 years.
And bullying his sexual harassment victims on top. I mean, that was a pretty sleazy episode in her life. That all those things, so the collective, as Greg says, all of this stuff.
What's the problem? What's the problem? She's a politician, so what's the problem?
She's a politician, so it's okay to...
I don't say it's okay, but that's the game. So what's the problem?
So he's the not problem
a
is,
see, he's not a politician, so we don't have all this other dirt on Donald Trump. We've got him screwing contractors.
She's paid for, and she only cares about herself. She stands for nothing.
On,
that's the whole thing.
First of all, here's the problem.
Stop.
You couldn't admit what the facts state.
Which is what?
Is that she's perjured? She's obstructed
justice. What are you
talking about?
She's
done all of it. When did you admit that?
Almost every single day. I actually ran something on.
No, what you said was, well, Donald Trump hasn't been. So you went right to Donald Trump. You accused me of doing the same thing.
I actually put on Twitter. This was my hashtag. You ready? For the alliteration for the letter C. For weeks now, it's been crooked. Excuse me. It's been corrupt over clueless. I know she's one of those things. She's a liar. She's a fraud. And I think Jim Comey laid it out perfectly. I don't defend Hillary Clinton. Everything you're calling her, I agree with. And yet, with all that said, I find him to be so inept and, quite frankly, so dumb, despite his business acumen, that I cannot give him this country.
I would rather have clueless over cop bashing, seeing as we're going with the alliteration.
I don't know about the cop bashing.
Stop. Over what's it? How can I make?
She's out there.
How about criminal associations?
Excuse me.
Criminal associates.
Like John Kennedy when he was with Sanjay and Cuomo, they were best friends.
Why is it about John Kennedy?
Well, I'm just saying that's a job, Greg. You're in bed with leaders from other countries that are less than desirable. I get it.
What are you kidding
me? So what? Donald Trump made money out of Russia. He had a fire at Paul Manafort this week because he was making money from the Ukraine and Russia. Why don't you talk about that for 1 second?
Well, he fired.
Criminal is it? It's the image of what it is, but how criminal
in
was
bed
it?
With our enemy. That's okay.
I said, how criminal was it?
Well, criminal. It's criminal to be in bed with the enemy, in my estimation. Yes, that's criminal. You may not go to jail, but
then Benghazi's got to be criminal. Then
listen,
because she killed those people in Benghazi, right? You know that.
You know, here's the thing.
She didn't use a gun.
The only he's not normally pro Hillary, but he's defending her now because he hates Donald Trump.
True.
He does not like it's an emotional response, is what I'm
but
saying.
But at least I would say this about him. He has the integrity to come out and say, I would rather have Hillary Clinton over Donald Trump in the White House, as opposed to some of these sniveling, weasel, cowardly Republicans types who will not, they'll just say, I'll vote for Gary Johnson, when essentially they're voting for Hillary Clinton when they make their comments and they pull a lever because a vote for Gary Johnson on their part is a vote for Hillary Clinton, actually.
Right. And I look at it. I just don't, you know, you look at polling out there and what the polling says is, you know, you can throw that here or there because it's all polling of registered voters. How many people are going to be registered in the next 2 months that are going to come out and vote? And how many corporate heads that come out there and say, that they're more with Hillary, go to the voting booth and vote for the other guy.
Well, that's because your hope.
How about it's not a hope of mine. It's just when I look at it, that's how I look at stuff. And you know what? Hey, listen, I don't think no matter who's president that this country is not going to survive. It will survive. But what's happening here is the ideology is really trying to switch of what America is. And that's the ideology that I don't agree with. I'm a constitutionalist. I'm not let's bend the Constitution. Let's do all those other things. It's not what I do.
How about this? Hillary Clinton is a racist. You know what she did regarding the private server and the emails? She blamed it on Colin Powell, our first African-American Secretary of State, a war hero. She blamed it on him, and he's fighting back now, saying that, yo, this woman's trying to throw me under the bus. I mean, that is racist. And she also treats blacks as just as votes, not as people, because as Donald Trump said, every 4 years they go to the White House and they're like, or the Senate or whatever it is, and it's bye-bye. I know the Senate 6 years. Okay, don't rewrite me on Twitter or whatever the hell.
Right.
So she's a racist. See how easy it is to throw around the racist word? She's a racist. And plus she said this. Remember she spoke in front of a church congregation and said this to them?
I don't feel no ways tired.
I mean, how insulting is that? That is so you support a racist?
Yes, I do. A racist horrendous. And somebody who's okay with rape and molestation. See, and who's dishonest.
In a court of law, and Sid would say that, he says, I didn't say a racist. I said an e-racist.
Hey, speaking of erase, whatever happened to your former teammate Mark Gastineau? I mean,
he's alive and well.
Is he really?
He's gained a little weight. He's had some health things that he had taken care of, but
some gastrointestinal.
I don't
see what you did there. Gastrointestinal.
Thank you.
Yeah. That's so funny.
Hey, listen, I can actually post. I was in the first two episodes of the Gastrointestinal Girls with Lisa and his daughter Brittany.
Really?
True story. Absolutely. I was in Brittany's apartment.
That's embarrassing.
I know.
To admit it.
I know. Hey, but I was there. Mark wasn't.
But the
husband. I was there and he wasn't.
That's true. But briefly, he's okay and he's
okay. You
he's
know,
alive and well.
Yeah, we just had an alumni reunion that the Jets sponsored back in August, and he was there. And
but nobody likes him, right? Like I know Klecko hates him. Nobody likes him. Right?
Let me just say this: it's almost you hate Trump. And you don't hate Trump because you don't know him. Your emotions are taken away with you. So control your emotions and understand Mark Gastineau is what he is, whether you like him or I don't.
I don't know him.
That's my point.
But Jet players have told me they hated him. They're lying?
But they hate him for all different reasons.
He's an asshole.
Hey, come on.
That's what they said to me.
I don't look at him like that. I got to tell you something. I don't look at him like that. I've known him for as long as everybody else. There were issues with Mark Gastineau about playing.
Yeah.
But
do you think he got screwed by the Strahan deal, Michael Strahan?
100%.
Yeah, he got
100%.
Totally. The record was stolen from him, actually.
Absolutely.
And so
given away.
Strahan is a thief.
The Strahan.
See, now you're being emotional.
Brett Favre did it. He was the one that came around and just stood there till Strahan went to him. Now, as you can remember, Strahan didn't jump at him. He kind of couldn't believe he's standing there. Yeah. And so he goes there, and by technicality, he made a sack because it was behind the line of scrimmage. Now, by the way, I would take that and I'd say that's wrong and it should be Mark Gastineau's thing.
Agree.
What do you mean what?
What?
See, that's your emotional giant fan speaking.
No. You're gonna give up the all time record.
No, I didn't say Michael Strahan should do anything.
Okay, who should do it?
I said it should be struck out because that was a nonsensical joke, stupid play.
Right.
Stole the sack record from Mark Gastineau. And by the way,
I
love Strahan.
Right.
He's a great guy. We play golf with him. He's a great guy.
Good guy. Likeable guy.
He didn't steal it.
Right.
It was given to him by Brett Favre.
I feel like you're being emotional for the Jets. I do. I feel like now you're being emotional.
How emotional is logic?
You kind of raised your voice. Your face got all red.
You need a psychiatrist. I'm going to tell you something.
Hey, Greg Buttle, man.
I'm going to print my ring on his forehead in a couple seconds. That's emotional.
Oh, my God. Yeah. What was a better defense? Let's get you. Your defense was a really good defense. I think underrated. The sack exchange, you guys at linebacker, really good defense. Or the Giants defense of the 80s. It was a better defense. If you even think about it, I'm going to punch you right in the stomach. I swear to God, Buttle.
That'd be the last punch you ever threw, bro.
Yeah, whatever.
You might hurt yourself.
Are you actually thinking about this?
Yeah, because you can't. You want to ask about a defense. I don't know where it ranked. I can't look at ranks, but statistically speaking.
You know what? Also, we're out of time. So, you know, we could continue this on Sid's podcast.
Oh, we could do that. All right.
What podcast? I'm not doing any podcast for him.
Screw that.
Yeah, that's right. He just buried himself.
Just so you know, you're on right after Hillary today.
Hey, Greg Buttle, thank you.
My pleasure, guys.
Fantastic guest. A New York legend, Greg Buttle, in studio with Bernie and Sid on 77 WABC. Back after this. All right, folks. Another kick-ass show here on the Bernie and Sid Show. Curtis and Kuby, they'll pick it up next in a matter of minutes.